Hello there, welcome. My name is Joel and I have the privilege of serving on the staff here at Panama Baptist Church. Thanks for being with us. Special Father's Day to you. Welcome to all of our fathers out there. I hope you're able to celebrate in a way that's meaningful for you today. Not a lot in the way of announcements, so let me just say the thing that I say pretty frequently, be watching the emails that we send out. We send two emails out a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays. Tuesdays focuses on the prayer needs in our church family. Thursday is specifically for announcements, things we want to let you know. We've sent some things out recently, some birth announcements. We've had a lot of babies born here in the last several months. Of course, it's time of year for grad parties. They want to get that information to you so you can celebrate with the families on this great achievement. Just some different reminders of trips or craft supplies. Of course, the giving report is in there every week. If you're not on the list for those emails and you want to be, send us a note, office@panamabaptist.org. That way we'll be sure we have your right email and you'll be staying informed. I would just mention, I've heard from a couple of you that you're not getting those emails like you want to be, but somehow they're not coming in. If that's you and for some reason something's gone wrong, please let me know. We want to be sure that you're getting that information. We'd love to help you out with that. Okay, I think that's it for now. Let me pray to begin our time together, and then the music crew will come and lead us in song. Would you pray with me? God, we are thankful for just the technology that allows us to do things like this, to send out information via email to try to help people stay informed. But ultimately, all of it is so that we can bring glory to you, to see your kingdom advance, to live deployed in our neighborhoods, our coworkers, our classmates, the people that we have around us. God, I pray that we would live in such a way to show your love to the people around us. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, here's the music team.
Oh, the grace that made me whole. Oh, the blood that washed my soul. What a gift from God above. What a gift from God above. Praise the Spirit, praise the Son. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men?
We're concluding our series this week that we've called The Gospel According to Ruth. I've enjoyed walking through this story. I hope you have as well. I hope you found it encouraging. Last week, we used the illustration of Hallmark movies. Do you remember that? And we kind of said there are two groups of people. There's a group of people that just love Hallmark movies and the romance, and even though they seem to follow kind of the same plot every time, they just enjoy them. They look forward to them every Christmas season. We said there's another group of people, those who don't like those movies at all, who just kind of hate them, and nothing ever works out like that. It's always too good to be true. I don't know which group you identified with. I've heard from many of you. Most of you identified with one of those two groups, and you didn't hesitate to tell me so. There's probably a third group that I didn't mention that I think some of you fell into, and that's just kind of the group in the middle that you just kind of tolerate it because somebody in your life really does enjoy those movies, but you're just kind of in the middle on it. And whether you get excited about the Hallmark movies or not, whether you care about them or not, we asked the question last week, why should you care about the Book of Ruth? Why should you care about this story? Why does it matter? Well, I want to try to bring it all together and wrap it up for you this week. You know, the book of Ruth, it starts with these six words. Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "During the time of the judges. See, to understand the book of Ruth, we have to understand the book of Judges. It comes right before Ruth, if you had your Bibles open. But to understand the book of Judges, we have to understand the book of Joshua. That comes right before the book of Judges. But to understand the book of Joshua, we have to understand the first five books of the Bible, right? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, all of that. But we've got a little less than 30 minutes now, so let me just try to make this quick. In the first five books of the Bible, what do we see? It's basically this, the creation of the world, right? That's where everything starts. And we see that God had a perfect design. But man, through sin, we left God's perfect design. But God still wanted a relationship with his people. But as we saw when we studied the book of Leviticus, God's holiness and man's sinfulness don't mix. So God entered into a covenant relationship with Israel, and he gave them laws that they needed to keep, right? The sacrifices that needed to be made in order for them to stay in that relationship. That's kind of what's covered, a very brief synopsis in the first five books. That takes us now to the book of Joshua. There we learn that God has delivered Israel from slavery in Egypt, and he's given them the promised land. And God states very clearly that if Israel remains faithful and keeps his laws, then they could continue to live in the promised land with God dwelling among them. See, Joshua is a good news book, one commentator said. And in the book of Joshua, we see that this generation moves into the promised land, defeating those who dwelled there. And we head into the book of Judges as this first generation of people is passing things off. So we go from the high of Joshua now into the valley of Judges, because in this book, the book of Judges, things change drastically for Israel. The purpose of the book of Judges is to show the absolute failure of Israel to keep their side of the covenant after God gives them the promised land. And the book of Judges paints a horrible picture of a rapid downward decline, both theologically and morally. Here's what one commentator said about the book of Judges. Let me just read it for you. In Judges, we see a terrible cycle repeated over and over. The people will sin and turn away from God, and thus a foreign nation will overrun them and oppress them. God, in his mercy and grace, will send a judge to deliver them and reestablish peace and blessing. The people, however, will soon turn away from God again, only to be conquered and oppressed again. God will send another judge to deliver them, and the pattern will repeat. However, as the story moves along, things seem to get worse and worse. Most of the judges themselves are tainted in some way, and they do not quite measure up in their behavior. Not only have the Israelites failed to drive out the Canaanites, but they are quickly becoming just like the Canaanites themselves. And at the end of the book, things are absolutely disastrous. And as we finish up in the book of Judges, we find the Israelites engaged in idol worship. People are leaving. There's a city that replicates the behavior from Sodom and Gomorrah. The Israelites turn against themselves, killing each other, and on and on and on it goes. It's this horrendous, just vile behavior. And the book of Judges is not a pretty picture at all. It's quite a depressing book. And the book of Judges closes with this verse. The very last verse in the book is chapter 21, verse 25, and it says this. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Everyone did whatever seemed right to him. In other words, Israel needs a king. This isn't going to work without a king. Which brings us to the book of Ruth. You know, and it's a nice change of pace, right? It's this beautiful, heartwarming story in the midst of evil and pain during the time of the judges. Is how the book starts. It's a book that's needed because it is rich in examples of noble character, kindness, faith, diligence, perseverance, it stands in sharp contrast to what we read in Judges. Interestingly enough, this story, this Ruth story, it would be read out loud every year during one of the particular festivals for generations to come. And it's a story that is beautiful and heartwarming, as I said, for several reasons. Let me give you three. The book of Ruth is a beautiful story because it starts with death, but ends with life. Right? There's Naomi in those first five verses where she loses her husband and her two sons. She has no grandchildren. One of her daughters-in-law decides to return home. Here's how Ruth starts again. This is verses 3 and verse 5. Naomi's husband, Elimelech, died, and she was left with her two sons. Both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and the woman was left without her two children and without her husband. But then the book of Ruth, a few chapters later, ends like this. Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. He slept with her, and the Lord granted conception to her, and she gave birth to a son. The woman said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord, who has not left you without a family redeemer today. May his name become well known in Israel. He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age. Indeed, your daughter-in-law, who loves you and is better to you than seven sons, has given birth to him." Naomi took the child, placed him on her lap, and became a mother to him. And the sun sets on Naomi in this story with just this beautiful picture of life, a newborn life, and restoration for Naomi and healing. But this is also a beautiful and heartwarming story for a second reason, and that is that a redeemer comes to the rescue. Right? Boaz, this man of noble character, which I didn't touch on this 2 weeks ago, but it's made all the more important and just amazing. Once you understand the time of Judges that they were living in, that there was hardly any moral character to be found, right? And also gives a little more insight into the reason why Boaz told Ruth, "Stay in this field, because I've put out instructions," Boaz told her, "to not harm you." And Boaz brings security and redemption to the two people who really needed it, who without it would have been lost and in serious trouble. So the story of Ruth is beautiful and heartwarming because it starts with death and ends with life, and that a redeemer comes to the rescue. But there's a third reason here, and that's that we see God at work. We saw God at work in all sorts of different ways in this story, and we've touched on them in the past few weeks, but let me just highlight them again, that God granting little mercies to Naomi to sustain her and to give her grace, how Ruth just so happened, right, through God's providence to wind up in Boaz's field, and Boaz just so happened to be a relative of the family in prime position to be a kinsman redeemer. And the other potential family redeemer that we met last week, who just so happened to decide that he wasn't the right person to fill that role. And God granting fertility to Ruth, providing a son named Obed that would bring new life to a weary, widowed Naomi. We see God at work weaving throughout this whole story. But it's here now with Obed where we begin to tie everything together. Because we still haven't answered the question that we ended last week with and that we started today with. Why is the story of Ruth in the Bible? Why should we care? I mean, sure, it's got a nice ending. Everybody loves a happily ever after ending, and it is a nice change of pace to the book of Judges. I get all that, but still, why? Well, to answer that question, we have to look at the Bible not as 66 different books, but as one book that tells one overarching story, the gospel story, the good news. See, the story of the Bible is primarily a history of man in a state of sin, rebelling against God, and of God's plan of redemption to bring people back to himself. And Naomi and Boaz and Ruth, they play a key part in this story of good news. Let's finish the book of Ruth, and here's the last few verses, starting in verse 17. The neighbor woman said, "A son has been born to Naomi," and they named him Obed, and he was the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now these are the family records of Perez. Perez fathered Hezron. Hezron fathered Ram. Ram fathered Amminadab. Amminadab fathered Nahshon. Nahshon fathered Salma. Salma fathered Boaz. Boaz fathered Obed. Obed fathered Jesse, and Jesse fathered David. See, Ruth just so happens to be the great-grandmother of a guy named David. Who's David? Well, the one of David and Goliath fame. David turns out to be the second king of Israel. He leads Israel to its peak of power and glory, the king that, as the book of Judges told us when it concluded, Israel desperately needed. And this king, David, he had great successes, right? He was a renowned military leader. He was a poet. He was a musician. He was someone after God's own heart. He was a writer. He wrote much of the book of Psalms. But for as great as David was, even he had failures. And not even this great King David could permanently restore man's relationship with God. See, man was still in need of a king, of an ultimate king, of an ultimate savior, the perfect kinsman redeemer. Because man, you and I, we were still lost. Our sin still divided us from the holiness of God. So why should we care? Well, you see, the book of Ruth is about much more than Naomi and Ruth and Boaz and Obed and David. Because in the book of Ruth, we see on a much larger scale, we see God at work. Do you remember the Joseph series? We were actually preaching through a character study in the life of Joseph exactly 2 years ago from right now. And in that series, we studied Joseph's life and how, in the end, Joseph said to his brothers, this is in Genesis chapter 50, those famous words, "You planned evil against me, but God planned it for good to bring about the present result, the survival of many people." We looked at in this series how God used the tragedies and heartache of Joseph to get his brothers, Judah specifically, right where God wanted them to be. And we said that Joseph's story wasn't really about Joseph. It's really a story about God saving the world, because Joseph's dad, Jacob, and one of Joseph's brothers, Judah, was in the line of the genealogy of Christ. And we illustrated that, we showed that to you by showing you this chart. And you can see the names there of Isaac and Jacob and Judah. But there's another name on this list, a couple more names, actually. Do you see it? Seven generations later, we run into the names of Boaz and Obed. See, we're still in the same line of Christ here. This is all telling one big story. In fact, Ruth herself is mentioned in the line of Christ. If we fast forward now to the New Testament, the book of Matthew starts with the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Here's what it says in verse 1, an account of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham fathered Isaac. Isaac fathered Jacob. Jacob fathered Judah and his brothers. Judah fathered Perez and Zerah by Tamar. And Perez fathered Hezron. Hezron fathered Aram. Let me skip down to verse 5. Salma fathered Boaz by Rahab. Boaz fathered Obed by Ruth. Obed fathered Jesse, and Jesse fathered King David. David fathered Solomon by Uriah's wife. And down to verse 16, Jacob fathered Joseph, the husband of Mary, who gave birth to Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Friends, the story of Ruth is really God at work to continue to put people right where He wanted them to be in order to bring about the Messiah, the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ. And in Ruth's story, God used a famine and heartache and catastrophe and a return home and a wheat field and a threshing floor and a kinsman redeemer to make all of that happen. Because on a much larger scale, we are also seeing in this story the ultimate Redeemer coming to the rescue. Matthew chapter 1, let's go back there again, verse 18. The birth of Jesus Christ came about this way. After his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, it was discovered before they came together that she was pregnant from the Holy Spirit. And she will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All of the prophecy, all of the waiting, all of the expectations, all of the hope had finally been fulfilled. Jesus said in Luke chapter 19 that he has come to seek and to save the lost. The ultimate kinsman redeemer was coming to your rescue and to mine. That's why we care about the book of Ruth. And he is our kinsman redeemer. Kinsman because he became human. He became one of us. And the redeemer because he was going to do what we could not do ourselves. And like for Naomi and Ruth in that little small story, for us too, this story starts with death, but it ends with life. See, when we lacked security and we could not earn it on our own, Christ died for you and for me. All right, Romans chapter 5, verse 8, God proves his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, we were still foreigners, we were still on the outside, Christ, the ultimate kinsman redeemer, died for us. And Ruth's great-grandson, David, wrote in Psalm 103, he redeems your life from the pit. He crowns you with faithful love and compassion. And Jesus came so that we may have life and that we may have it in abundance. John chapter 10, verse 10. Friends, the book of Ruth, it is a great story. It's a Hallmark movie type story, isn't it? Maybe even the first Hallmark movie, if we can say that. But it's not really a story about Ruth. And it's not a story about Boaz or Naomi. This is really a story about the Creator of the world, the Almighty God, putting a plan in place thousands of years ago to rescue and redeem you and me. And God used a grieving widow with a plan, a diligent, loyal foreigner, and a guy just trying to do the right and noble thing to help accomplish that plan. And those Hallmark movies, whether you love them or hate them, you know, they don't really change things. They don't really impact things. But this story, the book of Ruth, it could have no greater impact on you and your eternal future because your sin made it impossible to be reconciled with God. But through the line of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Judah and Ruth and Boaz and David, Jesus came and he died on the cross and paid the debt that you owe. And like those Hallmark movies, it might seem too good to be true, but this is grace wholly undeserved. It is kindness to anyone who believes. I hope this walk through the story of Ruth has been encouraging. But more than that, I hope it has helped you see how the Bible is a collection of stories telling one big story that has lasting and eternal impact on you and on me. And if you've got some questions about that impact, you've got some questions about your eternal destiny, we'd be honored to talk to you. Please reach out to us, send us a note. give us a phone call, leave a comment. We would be honored to talk to you about some of these things. Thanks for being with us this week. I'm praying for you as you seek to live deployed, showing the same love that God has shown you to the people around you. Panama Baptist Church, we'll see you next time. You are deployed.